بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وصفيه وخليله، أرسله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله ولو كره الكافرون. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تمسك بسنته إلى يوم الدين. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله سبحانه وتعالى، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. ثم أما بعد. Brothers and sisters, from the sunnah of life is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us as people who need to emulate and follow. And that is why you used to see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He created amongst every tribe and every nation a leader, and if not a leader, then He sent them a prophet. And this prophet was sent as a qudwa and an uswa to the people, meaning he was sent as a guide and as an exemplary to the people. Now, it is often commented and said that why is it that all the prophets and messengers that were sent to mankind were all men? Why was this the case? And then, doesn't it show that Islam is just a religion for men, since all of men were prophets, since all the prophets were men? And that none of the exemplaries that we have are for women? But brothers and sisters, even though it may be true that all the prophets and messengers were men, this does not mean that our beloved women, our mothers and our sisters, were deprived of an example. Indeed, the greatest of all the examples was that of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But other than his example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us at the end of Surah Al-Tahrim, وَضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا فِإِمْرَأَةِ فِرْعَوْنَ وَمَرْيَمْ إِبْنَةُ عِمْرَانَ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says at the end of this ayah, well, it's a conjunction of those two ayahs, the last two ayahs, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the first ayah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put forth the parable or the example for the believers of two believing women, right? The wife of Fir'aun, Asiya. And then in the second ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes on to mention Maryam, the daughter of Imran. None other than the beloved mother of Al-Masih, Isa ibn Maryam, alayhima as-salatu was-salam. So now, our sisters aren't deprived of an example, and this is something I really want to focus on today. The example of Maryam alayhi salam for the sisters. And let's take a look at how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes Maryam in the Quran. But rather, not only does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describe her in the Quran and mentions her situation, but rather, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to remember her story specifically. If you look in Surah Maryam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم واذكر في الكتاب مريم إذ انتبذت من أهلها مكانا شرقيا فاتخذت من دونهم حجابا فأرسلنا إليها روحنا فتمثل لها بشرا سويا. قالت إني أعوذ بالرحمن قالت إني أعوذ بالرحمن منك إن كنت تقيا قال إنما أنا رسول ربك لأهب لك غلاما زكيا قالت أنى يكون لي غلام ولم يمسسني بشر ولم أك بغيا قال كذلك قال ربك هو علي حين ولنجعله آية للناس ورحمة منا وكان أمرا مقضيا فحملته فانتبذت به مكانا قصيا فأجاءها المخاض إلى جذع النخلة قالت يا ليتني مت قبل هذا وكنت نسيا منسيا الله سبحانه وتعالى may he be praised and glorified says in these noble ayat to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam وَذْكُرْ فِي الْكِتَابِ مَرْيَمْ and remember in the book Maryam So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is clearly telling the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that remember the story of Maryam and then he goes on to mention what took place. Now one may question what is the wisdom behind Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling his beloved Prophet to remember the story of Maryam alayhi salam. As we study the story, you will see that the story of Maryam alayhi salam is a story that is filled with hardship. And it was sent to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a consolation. So that he may find solace in the story that not only were there messengers who faced trials and hardships, but those people who brought iman with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and those people who were from the righteous, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested and tried them as well in various ways. So this is one of the reasons. And the second reason is the Quraysh. They used to claim that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a man who just told stories. And a man who fabricated things, and a man who was possessed by the jinns. And indeed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was free from that. So thus Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed these ayat in specific detail to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to show the Quraysh that everything that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam spoke was nothing made up, but rather it was revelation from the very Lord that created them. And thus Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent them those ayat in such specific detail. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts off these ayat by saying وَذْكُرْ فِي الْكِتَابِ مَرْيَمْ And remember in the book Maryam إِذْ انْتَبَذَتْ مِنْ أَهْلِهَا مَكَانًا شَرْقِيًّا فَاتَّخَذَتْ مِنْ دُونِهِمْ حِجَابًا So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says And remember the story of Maryam when she went to the eastern part of her city and she made a barrier or a partition between herself and the people and obviously this was due to the fact that Maryam she was an abidah that she was a worshipper of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. She devoted herself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and used to seclude herself from the people so that she wouldn't be distracted by their speech and their statements and all their other things that they were busied with. But rather she wanted to busy herself with the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So she would go to the eastern part of the city and she would seclude herself for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it's amazing this sunnah of the righteous people that we used to see this in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as well before his revelation the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to take off to the cave of Hira to seclude himself from the people and just leave himself contemplating in the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and in his worship subhanallah al-azim indeed what a beautiful sunnah that is so in this situation when Maryam alayhi salam is secluded and all alone Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decides to send her a messenger, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says that we sent her a messenger, meaning that we sent her an angel. فَتَمَثَّلَ لَهَا بَشَرًا سَوِيًّا And he took the shape or the form of a beautiful man. He took the shape and form of a beautiful man. And I want you to take a moment and reflect that if something like this was to happen in our times, how would the woman react? not only the Muslim women, but other than the Muslim women. Or actually vice versa. Not only the non-Muslim women, but the Muslim women as well. And that is with great sadness. That in our times, when a man comes to our believing Muslim women, he approaches her, she might even begin to initiate a conversation with him. And how many times we have seen it, you know, at the high school bus stops, that you have the intermingling of men and women. The sisters are asking the guys, how are you doing, what's going on, how's this, how's that. And you have the same thing coming from the guys as well. But if you look at the example of Maryam alayhi salam, subhanAllah, it's just beautiful. She says, "Inni a'udhu bir-Rahmani minka in kunta taqiyya." She says, "I seek refuge in Ar-Rahman. I seek refuge in the most beneficent, if indeed you are a person that fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala." And indeed this ayah alone is filled with many lessons and blessings, subhanAllah. One of the most apparent lessons and blessings in this is that division that a woman has with all mahram men, that she has this barrier of modesty and bashfulness, that she doesn't want to mix with those men who are non-mahram to her. And this is what we see from Maryam alayhi salam. She says, "I seek refuge in Allah from you." Obviously he wasn't an evil man. He didn't come or say anything evil. So she doesn't know what he's all about yet. But she also reminds him of something as well at the same time. "In kunta taqiyya." That if you fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you'll stay away from me. Right? And this is a beautiful example, and one thing that we benefit from this is that the reminder of taqwa will only benefit the believer. That, let's just say you're in a situation, men and women, or a man and a woman are alone. If it's a Muslim man and a non-Muslim woman, the Muslim man can't tell the woman, fear Allah. She aslan originally has no belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's on the scenario that they're about to do something unvirtuous or something that is wrong, obviously. But if this woman, she has belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the man tells her, fear Allah. Or you can reverse the scenario, and the woman tells the man, fear Allah. And he has belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he will leave her for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we see this scenario actually took place in history. That the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam mentioned the scenario or the story of three men who one day went into a cave and were trapped inside. So one of them said that we will not leave this cave until we mention those things that we did sincerely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the first man, he says, "Ya Allah, I had two parents who were old in age, and I had my children and my wife as well. And one day I came home late and my parents had gone to sleep. So I didn't feed my wife and my children until I fed my parents first." This is what the first man said. So he said, "Ya Allah, if I did this for your sake and your sake alone, then alleviate us of this hardship." So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala moved the barrier from in front of the cave a little bit. Now the second man, and this is the main point of the story that I want to get to, is that he said, "Ya Allah, indeed there was a beloved cousin to me, and I used to love her the most that any man could love a woman. And one day she came seeking money from me. And I said that I will only give you this money if you seclude yourself with me," meaning that you fornicate with me. So now when they're in that room alone, she tells the man, right, and this is her cousin, believing man, she says, "If you fear Allah, then you will not pierce the seal of virginity except with this due rite," meaning that you will marry me first before we do this act. So she reminded the man of the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. She said, "Fear Allah, وَلَا تَخُدُّ الْخَاتِمَ إِلَّا بِحَقِّهِ," and do not pierce the seal except with its due right, meaning through marriage. So this man was reminded of the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he left her. And then he said, "Ya Allah, I did this for your sake and your sake alone." SubhanAllah al-Azim. This is the example of the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then the third man, he had a slave, and he didn't give his slave his money before he left. So he took the slave's money and invested it. And then one day the slave came back and he said, "You know, oh my master, everything that I have done, I didn't receive my wages. So please give me my wages." So the money that he invested was everything that was in front of him. He said, "Everything you see in front of you today is yours." And then the slave said, "Do not mock me. You know, I may be poor, but you do not have the right to mock me." And he said, "I am not mocking you. Indeed, everything you see in front of you is yours." So the Prophet ﷺ mentions that he took everything, not leaving a single sheep behind. So brothers and sisters, the example that we took from the story was that of the second man. That the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can prevent a man from doing evil sins and deeds. And thus the lesson that we derive from the ayah that is mentioned is that you should always be in the, you know, a company of the believers. That it is only by being through the company of the believers that you can remind one another of the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, thus it will prevent you from doing evil deeds. And this is what happened in the case of Maryam alayhi salam. She knew that it was only the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that had he been an unrighteous man, meaning that he was still a believer but an unrighteous man, it would only be the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that would prevent him from doing anything wrong and unlawful with her. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues and goes on to tell us in the next ayah that this man that was sent to her was none other than an angel who came to bless Maryam alayhi salam with the glad tidings of a child. And Maryam alayhi salam becomes astonished and she says, how can I have a child? وَلَمْ يَمْسَسْنِي بَشَرْ وَلَمْ أَكُنْ بَغِيَّةً. That no man has ever touched me, meaning that I have never been married and nor am I a woman who is lewd and evil. So how can I have a child? And then the angel responds to her, قَالَ كَذَلِكَ. That he said, just like that. قَالَ رَبُّكِ هُوَ عَلَيَّ هَيِّمْ. Just like that, and your Lord is able to do anything that he wishes. And this is when Jibreel alayhi salam actually breathed in to Maryam alayhi salam, and thus she started to conceive a child by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without having any man ever having touched her before. And this is a great miracle from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Scientifically, you would never be able to prove this. And this is one of the beauties of Iman, that we believe in the unseen. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala compels us and obliges us with the belief in the unseen. That when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions anything to us in the Quran, we have to believe it. And it's with great sadness that sometimes we find Muslims who question the authority of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They will say, and how is it possible that Maryam conceived a child without having any man touched her, when we know that scientifically this is not possible. Brothers and sisters, when the text of the Quran and the Sunnah come forth, it is upon every believer to put any scientific fact behind them. For indeed, there are those matters that science will approve of, and there are those matters that science won't approve of. But as believers, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us anything in the Quran, or if anything was sent through the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we say sami'na wa ata'na, that we hear and we obey. And thus is the story with Maryam alayhi salam, that if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was able to create Adam alayhi salam, the great prophet, then why is it such a big deal that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Isa alayhi salam from a woman, when he created Adam alayhi salam from absolutely nothing, and there was nothing in existence? Subhanallah, this is an even greater miracle. So this is just an example of how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala compels us and obliges us to believe in the unseen and to accept those facts whether our intellects accept them or not. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he goes on to continue in the story and says, so thus the pangs of labor came upon Maryam alayhi salam, and she was eventually led to a tree upon where she collapsed, and she said, Ya laytani mittu qabla hadha wa kuntu nasiyan mansiya. That woe to me, had I only died before this event and was of someone who was forgotten and never came into existence. Now subhanallah al-azim, upon contemplating this ayah, you see two things. That one, not only are the pangs of labor so great and severe that would cause a woman to despair of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but rather, how much we fear, how much a person fears being spoken about even evilly. And this is the greater, you know, dilemma that Maryam alayhi salam had. She didn't fear the pangs of labor. She knew that, you know, pain will come. It was the sunnah of life that one has to face sooner or later. But what she did fear is that she devoted her whole life to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And now that she does this, that she is being tested by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, people are going to say that, you know, Maryam was a fornicator. A'udhu billah, subhanallah. That Maryam was a fornicator. The woman that the people knew for all of their lives to be a worshipper of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to be as a woman who preserved her chastity, the people would come and now say that this woman fornicated. And this is another lesson for all of mankind, that you see that from the sunnah of life, is that those people who are imams and leaders in their community, they are the people who are most frequently spoken about. That they commit one small mistake, and even not a mistake, something that you conceive as a mistake, then all of a sudden it becomes the talk of the town. And this was the case of Maryam alayhi salam, that she was known for her devotion to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tried her and tested her with this. And thus she became the center of attention once again. But this time, it's because she's conceiving a child. And again, in their minds, they're like, how is it possible that a woman can conceive a child without having any man touched her? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tried those people with it. So those people who believed in this miracle of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala were considered the believers. And those people who denied and neglected this ayah or this proof from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then they were considered the disbelievers. So then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes on and continues. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that Jibreel, from the bottom of the earth, he calls upon her. Right? He says, فَنَادَى مِن تَحْتِهَا أَلَّا تَحْزَنِي قَدْ جَعَلَ رَبُّكِ تَحْتَكِ سَرِيًّا. So that Jibreel alayhi salam calls Maryam from under the ground and he says, do not worry, you know, لا تحزني, do not be sad, do not despair. قَدْ جَعَلَ رَبُّكِ تَحْتَكِ سَرِيًّا. That indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made for you a river that flows underneath you. Right? Again, another miracle from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You're in a barren desert and all of a sudden a river starts flowing. Another miracle from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you see that this is from the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that those people who begin to despair from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he sends them ease. And the beginning of Maryam alayhi salam's ease was the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had sent her this river. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, again, he sends her another miracle. And obviously we don't conceive these things as big miracles as we weren't present. But picture this in your mind, that you're in a barren desert land. A woman who is pregnant all by herself, how is she going to take care of herself? It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who is taking care of her. And again, this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protects and takes care of his awliya. So then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he tells Maryam that go back to the tree trunk that you were and shake it and fresh dates will fall upon you. وَهُزِّي إِلَيْكِ بِجِذْءِ النَّخْلَةِ تُسَاقِطْ عَلَيْكِ رُطَبًا جَنِيًا. That go back to that tree trunk and shake it. And obviously, these date palm trees, you know, they're not easy to shake. But another miracle from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this weak woman who is in labor, right, she's facing the pangs of labor, is able to shake the date palm tree and the dates fall upon her. And what we understand from this, and this is a, you know, more of a medical fact that Islam comes to concur, is that when a woman is pregnant, right, and just before labor, it is advised for her to have dates. Because it helps in the conception of the child and makes the child healthy. And this is why it is also from the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ that when a child is born, one of the first things that you do is that you're supposed to take half of a date, chew it into small bits, and then put it in the baby's mouth. And this protects the baby from having or catching any diseases or viruses, as the doctors say. And for further details, you know, Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, he had a famous book called At-Tibb al-Nabawi, meaning the prophetic medicine. And you can look it up over there, bi-ithnillahi ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes on in this beautiful story of Maryam alayhi salam. And he goes on to say that كُلِي وَشْرُبِي وَكَرِّي عَيْنًا فَإِمَّا تَرَيِنَّ مِنَ الْبَشْرِ أَحَدًا فَقُولِي إِنِّي نَظَرْتُ لِلرَّحْمَنِ صَوْمًا وَلَنْ أُكَلِّمَ الْيَوْمَ إِنْسِيًّا. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says that eat and drink in relaxation. وَكَرِّي عَيْنًا. And relax yourself and calm yourself. Meaning that do not worry about what's going to happen. I, meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, will take care of the affairs. Right? This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling her through Jibreel. And now this is an interesting point, that if any of mankind comes to you, then say, indeed I am preserving a fast for Allah, and I shall not speak to any of mankind today. Meaning that anyone from mankind, I will not speak to him today. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is telling Maryam alayhi salam, that people will come to you, and they will mock you, and They will say evil things about you, but do not say anything to them. Right? For indeed I have preserved a fast for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some of the Mufassirun, they mention a great benefit and blessing over here, is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala favored the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And how this was, is that during the past, meaning the ummahs, before the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they were informed to fast, not only in abstinence from food, drink, and marital relations, but also in speech as well. That while they were fasting, they were not allowed to speak. And this is why you see in this ayah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells Maryam to say, إِنِّي نَظَرْتُ لِلرَّحْمَنِ صَوْمًا, that indeed I am preserving a fast for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then it would be understood that she is not allowed to talk. And obviously, you may be thinking that how is she supposed to tell the people this if she can't talk? Then the Mufassirun say about this, that this was through sign language. So this is how you may understand the misconception. So now, as the story goes on, this is when the climax, you know, arrives. That they say, Ya Maryam, لَقَدَ جِئْتِ شَيْئًا فَرِيَّ, you have come with this atrocity, that you were a woman we loved, we took care of, you were our daughter, you were raised, you know, in the places of worship. What did you do? How did you conceive this child? How could you betray us like that? That's what they're trying to say. Right? And now you can imagine, this woman who stayed chaste all of her life for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, now she is being accused of a deed that she never committed. How would such a person feel? And you see that this is a trial that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts the believers through. Yusuf alayhi salam was put through it when he was tested. And then Aisha radiallahu anha, the beloved wife of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Umm al-Mu'mineen, the mother of the believers, she was tested with this as well. And thus, so was Maryam alayhi salam. That she was tested through this as well, that she was accused of doing something evil and cynical that none of us should even imagine of doing. Yet they accuse one of the more righteous people of their times of doing it. Right? And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in concluding Maryam's story, and then goes on to Isa's story in the surah, he tells what the people said to her. And he says, Ya ukhta Harun, meaning Ya Maryam, O sister of Harun. And this isn't Harun, the brother of Musa, but this is another Harun, a righteous man from their times. Ya ukhta Harun, ما كان أبوك مرأة سوء وما كانت أمك بغية. That your wife was not an evil or wicked man, your father wasn't an evil or wicked man, and nor was your mother known for fornication or someone who did these evil deeds. Then how did you come across this, or how did you come about doing this? And the benefit that we derive from this, and this is something I'd really like to emphasize on, is that these people, thousands and thousands of years ago, understood something that a lot of people in our times have trouble understanding. And that is the example of the parents. In those times, if a person did something bad, it was due to the lack of tarbiyah that they were given. And they understood this. In our times, when our children do something bad, we like to say, oh, it's because they're watching TV all day and they're watching these evil programs. Or it's because of their friends and the people that hang around it at school. Now, more than likely, they are affected by these things, their friends and watching TV. But brothers and sisters, the thing that affects them the most is the way they are raised with their parents. Is the way that we raise our children is what affects them the most. If during the ripe ages of 2, 3 and 4, we set bad examples for them, how do we expect to raise good people and righteous people? It's like, you know, planting a seed of evil and expecting good fruits from it. It's not logically possible. So brothers and sisters, this is one of the lessons that they understood from the past. That they told to Maryam that your mother wasn't evil, nor was your father evil. Then how did you become evil? This is something they understood. And this is something we need to understand today as well. That as Muslims, alhamdulillah, we're all here in the masjid today. Why is it that we don't bring our children to the masajid? Why is it we're not educating our children about Islam? Why is it that we're not giving our children the proper tarbiyah that Islam requests for? Now not only is it desired by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but you have to understand, this is something that will benefit them in this dunya as well. That this tarbiyah or Islamic mentality and the manners and akhlaq of Islam is something that will benefit the children as well. And this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala expects good tarbiyah from us. That it starts from the home. It starts from the parents. So So if you expect and want good children, then know and realize the fact that you have to start by portraying it by example, and this is the only way you will get it after the tawfiq of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين من كل ذنب فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. Brothers and sisters, as I mentioned at the beginning of the khutbah, this khutbah today was directed towards the sisters in the example of Maryam alayhi salam. But as we mentioned that ayah in the very beginning, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that He sent this message or this parable for all of the believers. That even though we relate more to those role models who are of the same gender as us, meaning that Maryam alayhi salam is a woman and she is a role model for the women, it's more congenial that way. But she's also an example for the men as well. And all these benefits and lessons we have heard of today are things that not only that our sisters need to apply, but the brothers need to apply as well. So the last thing, or one of the last things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He commands all the believers with after they are tested and they surpass the test, is the praising of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and granting thanks to Him that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was able to get them through this trial. And this is why we see in the ayat in Surah Al-Imran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about Maryam, وَإِذْ قَالَتِ الْمَلَائِكَةُ يَا مَرْيَمُ إِنَّ اللَّهَ اصْطَفَاكِ وَطَهَّرَكِ وَاصْطَفَاكِ عَلَى النِّسَاءِ الْعَالَمِينَ يَا مَرْيَمُ قُنُوتِي لِرَبِّكِ وَاسْجُدِي وَارْكَعِي مَعَ الرَّاكِعِينَ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says over here that, and remember when the angel said, O Maryam, indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has elevated your ranks and has purified you and has elevated your ranks even more and has made you from the best of the women of this dunya. So O Maryam, be obedient to your Lord. Right? Uqnuti li rabbiki. Be obedient to your Lord. Wasjudi warka'i ma'a raki'in. So prostrate and bow down to your Lord. Right? This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands her with. And indeed, this is another great example for us. And I'm going to be ending off soon with this last quote. That from the sunnah of life, and from those things that accompanies iman, is that we are bound to be tested sooner or later. And it's all about how we face this test. Our salaf, our predecessors, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with them, they used to say that while we are being tested, we used to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for three things. They used to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that this trial wasn't in their deen. Meaning that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't try them in their deen. That He didn't give them any tribulation or any doubts about their deen. And this they used to consider a blessing, so they used to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this. Secondly, they used to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He didn't make this trial as great as it could have been. Meaning that, let's just say you're walking on the street, a man comes and robs you of $100. Right? We need to be thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that it is by His praise that this man didn't rob us of $1,000. They used to be thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during the trials. And lastly, they used to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for what? That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted them patience during this time of tribulation. That you can see how crazy a man can go during a time of tribulation. But it is only by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's will and mercy that He grants the believers patience. So thus they used to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this. And indeed, in Maryam alayhi salam, and in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and in our predecessors, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with them all, is a great example for every single one of us. So it is upon each and every single one of us to learn their stories, to derive the lessons, and to implement those lessons into our daily lives. So brothers and sisters, I remind you of another great order and commandment that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us with when He said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَمَلَائِكَتَهُ يُصَلُّونَ عَلَى النَّبِيِّ يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا صَلُّوا عَلَيْهِ وَسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم اغفر لحينا وميتنا وشاهدنا وغائبنا وصغيرنا وكبيرنا وذكرنا وأنثانا، وإذا أحييت أحدا منا فأحيي على الإسلام، وإذا توفيت أحدا منا فتوفاه على الإيمان. اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين، اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين، اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين. اللهم انصر إخواننا المستضعفين في كل مكان، اللهم انصر إخواننا المستضعفين في كل مكان، وارفع رايتك، وارفع رايتك، اللهم ارفع رايتك وانصر المسلمين في كل مكان يا رب العالمين. اللهم إنا نعوذ برضاك من سخطك، وبمعافاتك من عقوبتك، وبك منك، ولا نحصي الثناء عليك أنت كما أثنيت على نفسك. وصلى اللهم وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. قوموا إلى صلاتكم يرحمكم الله.
الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن محمد رسول الله، أشهد أن محمد رسول الله. حي للصلاة، حي للصلاة، حي للصلاة، حي للصلاة، قد قامت الصلاة، قد قامت الصلاة. الله أكبر الله أكبر، لا إله إلا الله.
So اعتدلوا، train the lines and fill the gaps. For indeed, the straightening of the lines and the filling of the gaps is part of the perfection of the salah. Allahu Akbar. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. سبح اسم ربك الأعلى، الذي خلق فسوى، والذي قدر فهدى، والذي أخرج المرعى فجعله غثاء أحوى. سنقرئك فلا تنسى إلا ما شاء الله، إنه يعلم الجهر وما يخفى. ونيسرك لليسرى فذكر إن نفعت الذكرى، سيذكر من يخشى ويتجنبها الأشقى، الذي يصلى النار الكبرى ثم لا يموت فيها ولا يحيا، قد أفلح من تزكى وذكر اسم ربه فصلى، بل تؤثرون الحياة الدنيا والآخرة خيرا وأبقى، إن هذا لفي الصحف الأولى، صحف إبراهيم وموسى. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. آمين. قل هو الله أحد، الله الصمد، لم يلد ولم يولد، ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.